The most solemn warning in all of the Bible is found in Revelation chapter 14, where the Bible says, do not worship the beast, do not worship his image, neither receive the mark of the beast. In this video, we are going to identify what the mark of the beast is. Is it a chip? Is it the COVID-19 vaccine? What is the mark of the beast? Stay tuned and you find the shocking answer in this video. If you've not subscribed yet to our channel, subscribe to our channel, click on the bell and on all, you'll receive the notifications when we upload new videos. Videos on prophecy, on marriage, on health, variety of videos to prepare you for Jesus' soon return. Let's get to our topic today, the mark of the beast. What we need to understand, and we can already eliminate the vaccine or a chip by just understanding what the phrase mark of the beast means. Well, it's the mark of the beast. Who's the beast? If you've kept up to date with our channel, you would have seen that we have identified the Antichrist as the Roman Catholic Church or the papacy. Let's see what the Reformers said about this. All roads lead to Rome, page 205, 1991. A great cloud of witnesses, Wycliffe, Tyndale, Luther, Calvin, Cranmer, in the 17th century, Bunyan, the translators of the King James Bible, and the men who published the Westminster and Baptist Confessions of Faith, Sir Isaac Newton, John Wesley, Jonathan Whitfield, Jonathan Edwards, and more recently, Charles Spurgeon, Bishop J. Riley, and Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones, these men, among countless others, all saw the office of the papacy as the Antichrist. If you are shocked currently at this moment, please go to the link below and you can click on the link where I expose the Antichrist. The Roman Catholic Church fits all the points identified in Daniel chapter 7 and Revelation chapter 13 when it talks about the beast. Listen to what Martin Luther said. History of the Reformation of the 16th century. Martin Luther proved by the revelations of Daniel and St. John, by the epistles of St. Paul, St. Peter, and St. Jude, that the reign of Antichrist predicted and described in the Bible was the papacy. There's no doubt about it, it's just not popular to say it anymore. But currently we see the papacy ascending back to the power it had through the Dark Ages when they killed up to 100 million Christians for not believing what they said. Now Pope Francis is really moving the ship of the Antichrist forward to put them at center stage again so that they can enforce the mark of the beast via the second beast of Revelation chapter 13. Now who is the second beast of Revelation 13? Well, it's the United States of America. Below you will find a link again to that video where I show from the Bible that the United States of America is the lamb-like beast that speaks like a dragon in Revelation chapter 13. So let's get back to the phrase, the mark of the beast. It's the mark of the beast. Who's the beast? It's the papacy. So it's the mark of the papacy. Is the vaccine a mark of the papacy? The answer is no. Is a microchip the mark of the papacy? The answer is no. The key issue in Revelation 13, Revelation 14 is worship. Seven times the word worshipped or worship is used in Revelation 13 and 14. That's many times in just two chapters. Only once does God say, worship me. Revelation 14 verse 7. Worship the creator of the heavens and the earth. But six times the Bible refers to worshiping the Antichrist or worship the Antichrist or worship the dragon because he gives power unto the beast. That's the devil. So the mark of the beast is the mark of the papacy and it has everything to do with worship. It has nothing to do with a vaccine. They might use the vaccine as a vehicle to use technology and to enforce the mark, but it isn't the mark of the beast. Revelation 13 says that the second beast speaks like a dragon. How does a nation speak like a dragon? Well, when you look into the Old Testament, we find the answers. In Daniel chapter 3, King Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, says everyone must worship an image. This image was 6 by 6 by 60. Very fascinating. And this image needed to be worshipped. In Revelation chapter 13, you have the image to the beast. And you need to worship this image to the beast. And three Hebrew boys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, did not bow down to this image. So the government made a law contradicting God's law, and the penalty was death. That is a nation speaking like a dragon. Daniel chapter 6. King Darius makes a decree that you need to worship him for 30 days or else you're thrown into the lion's den. Once again, the government makes a law that contradicts God's law, and if you do not worship, you are killed. So here we have examples where laws were made contradicting worship of God, and if you did not comply, you were killed. In the book of Revelation chapter 13, a law would be made that contradicts God's law. And if you do not worship that way, they say, you may not buy and sell. And later on, a death decree will come out and you will be killed. Now let's get a better understanding of Revelation chapter 13 and the mark of the beast. Let's read Revelation 14:11. And the smoke of their torment ascends forever and ever, and they have no rest day or night to worship the beast and his image, and whoever receives the mark of his name. Well, here we have it. It's the mark of the beast. The beast is the papacy. It's the mark of his name, now Revelation 14:11 says. Where does God put the seal of God? The seal of God is placed in the forehead of the 144,000. That's Revelation chapter 7. Revelation 14 talks about the same group, the 144,000, with the seal of God, but then it says the name of God in their foreheads. The mark of the beast is placed in the forehead. The seal of God is placed in the forehead. The mark of the beast is also placed in the hand, because the works follows the mind, the decision to worship the beast. Remember that when the mark of the beast is placed in the forehead, it's got nothing to do with a visible mark, but rather that you will make your decisions in line with the beast and worshiping the beast. That which they enforce, that law which they bring in, you will follow by making the decision, and your works would follow by making that decision. Therefore, in the mind and in the hand. Ecclesiastes 9 says, whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all your might. It has to do with your works. God's seal is only placed in the forehead because it's only based upon your decision to worship God in line with the law of God. Revelation 14:11 talks about those who receive the mark of the beast. Listen to verse 12, the very next verse. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are those who keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus. So those who receive the mark of the beast's name contradict God's law. Those who receive the seal of God keep God's law. Clear distinction made here in the book of Revelation. Now we've already discovered what the seal of God is. It's the name of God in your forehead. The name of God is his character and his authority, which is the law of God, and the law which in within the law of God that points to him as the creator of the heavens and the earth, which gives him authority, is the Sabbath. The Sabbath is the outward seal that you are worshiping Jehovah, the Almighty God. If you've not watched that video yet, go to the description below. I will paste the link where you can watch the video, the twofold seal of God. It is the law of God placed in the mind. The Holy Spirit writes it on the mind and on the heart. And the Sabbath is the one that seals you, that shows the evidence that God is the creator of the heavens and the earth, which is Jesus Christ himself. So the mark of the beast is the mark of his name. The seal of God contains his title, his territory, and his name, which you find in the fourth commandment. The Lord made the heavens and the earth and the sea and the fountains and everything in it, and therefore he blessed the Sabbath day. So there you have the Lord, his name, made, he's the creator, the heavens and the earth, his territory. So the seal of God is his Sabbath, it is the law of God, and the Sabbath is the one that points to him as the creator. The mark of his name has to do with the law of the beast, it has to do with the character of the beast and his day. Could that be? Let's read Ezekiel chapter 20 verse 20. Hallow my Sabbaths, and they will be a sign between me and you, that you might know that I am the Lord your God. So the Sabbath points to the fact that God is our God. That's the evidence that you're worshiping the creator of the heavens and the earth. But the beast's law, the beast enforcing a law, contradicts this law. Let's see what the beast says is their mark. Let's ask them. Let me not interpret for you. Let me ask the beast. Beast, please tell me. Papacy, what is your mark? The Catholic Catechism. Which day is the Sabbath day? Answer, Saturday is the Sabbath day. Question, why do we observe Sunday instead of Saturday? Answer, we observe Sunday instead of Saturday because the Catholic Church transferred the solemnity from Saturday to Sunday. So the beast says, we change the Sabbath from Saturday to Sunday. Now listen to what the beast says further. Listen to what the papacy says. C.F. Thomas, October 28, 1895. Of course the Catholic Church claims the change was her act. This is the change from Sabbath to Sunday. And the act is a mark of her ecclesiastical power and authority in religious matters. The mark of his name has to do with his character and his authority. The beast has his own law. He took out the second commandment because it says, thou shalt not have any graven images, and moved all the commandments up one and took the tenth one, split it in two, and turned it upside down. And therefore, they have their own ten commandments, their own character. But they also have their own authority, which is Sunday. Sunday worship. What is the issue in the last days? Worship. Worship the Creator on his Sabbath day, pointing to him as the Creator of the heavens and the earth. Or receive the mark of the beast by worshiping the beast by choosing Sunday. They say that's their mark. More evidence. Catholic record, September 1, 1923. Sunday is a mark of our authority. The church is above the Bible, and this transference of Sabbath observance is proof of that fact. Our Sunday visitor, February 5, 1950. Protestants do not realize that by observing Sunday, they accept the authority of the spokesperson of the church, which is the Pope. The papacy themselves says, their mark that has to do with worship is that they will bring in a law via the second beast, which is the United States of America, a Sunday law, telling everyone to worship on Sunday or rest, and working on Saturday, the Sabbath, contradicting God's law. And once again, just like in Daniel 3 and Daniel 6, God's people will be faced with a question, who do I worship? Will you stand and worship God on his holy Sabbath day, even facing death? Or will you follow and worship the beast on Sunday? And you say, man, this sounds crazy. A Sunday law? I mean, how could they do this? They are Muslims, they are Jews, etc. How can they bring in a law like this? Well, they're not going to do it to say, hey, this is the mark of the beast. It's going to be a family day, a day off. You still get paid even if you don't work on Sunday. People will get excited. Doesn't matter which religion you're a part of. And the Pope is preparing the world for this. And that's why Pope John Paul II will be seen kissing the Quran. Or the Pope goes and prays at the Western Wall in Jerusalem, getting the favor of the Jews. Or he goes and worships with the Buddhists and all the other Sunday churches in the world, by the way, like Kenneth Copeland, when he tells the Pope, you know, we love you and we speak in tongues and we speak towards you, etc. And the Pope speaking to all the pastors that was in his church. He's preparing the world for this event. And the Bible predicted that this would happen, Daniel 7:25. And think to change times and laws. The little horn will think to change times and law. The only commandment that's both a law and a time is the Sabbath commandment. He changed the Sabbath from Saturday to Sunday, and he says, it is my mark of authority. St. Catherine Catholic Church, Sentinel, May 21, 1995. This is their own writings. Perhaps the boldest thing, the most revolutionary change the church ever did happen in the first century. The holy day, the Sabbath, was changed from Saturday to Sunday, not from any directions noted in the scriptures, but from the church's sense of its own power. When Emperor Constantine, a pagan sun worshipper, came to power in AD 13, he legalized Christianity and made the first Sunday keeping law. His infamous Sunday enforcement law of March 7, AD 321 reads as follows. On the venerable day of the sun, let the magistrates and people residing in cities rest, and let all workshops be closed. If you've not watched my video called Who Changed the Sabbath, go and watch the link below. Constantine brought in the first Sunday law in 321 AD. The papacy took on this day, saying this is now the new worship day, and Christianity started to follow during the Dark Ages, following the papacy. And if you did not worship on Sunday, if you worshiped on Saturday, you were persecuted during the Dark Ages. The same thing is going to happen again in the end of time when the United States of America makes a Sunday law. And the question is, if you worship on Sunday today, do you have the mark of the beast? The answer is no. When the United States of America makes a national Sunday law and people follow, they will receive the mark of the beast. And you will not be able to buy and sell if you do not receive the mark of the beast or choose to follow to worship on Sunday. This day belongs to the beast, but it's not the mark of the beast yet. How many people will follow this mark of the beast? Revelation 13:3. And I saw one of his heads as he had been mortally wounded, and his deadly wound was healed. And all the world marveled and followed the beast. Everyone will follow and listen to how they're preparing the world for it. Is this in the news, a national Sunday law? Christianity Today in 1976, Harold Lindzel said, all businesses, including gasoline stations and restaurants, should close every Sunday by force of legislative fiat through the duly elected officials of the people. So he's saying the Christians need to choose the leaders and the leaders need to enforce Sunday off. That sounds like the mark of the beast. Pat Robinson said, it is not the duty of any particular group of people. It's not the duty of the church, but it's the duty of the government of its people to thus proclaim a day of Sabbath to be universally observed throughout the length and breadth of our land. Sunday as the Lord's Day. If we as a nation would escape the doldrums of increased trouble as God's hand rests heavily upon his people, opposition to Sunday nationally declared must cease. So Pat Robinson says to bring in a Sunday law and the government must do it. And we must cease fighting against it. Listen to the European Union. European bishops back proposed EU law on Sunday rest. They want a Sunday law in the European Union. The Catholic Church is pushing towards this. In Italy, in Germany, in Croatia, we have these Sunday laws. You get penalized for doing work on Sunday in these countries. Brazil is looking at this. And many other countries, the world is being prepared for a Sunday law, my friends. Listen to what happens in India, who is a non-Christian. They are Christians, but it's not really a Christian country. Listen to what it says. Shops to be closed on Sundays in India. Can you believe it? What about Israel, mostly Muslims and Jews? Do we see that they want Sundays off there? Israel adopts Sundays off. And the article says, now they can watch baseball like the Americans on Sunday. So they want Sundays off. Do you see? This is worldwide, my friends. This is not just for Christian nations. Even France, a secular country. This article says, France to look at laws curbing Sunday shopping. Here we see it, my friends. They're looking towards laws towards this. What about South Africa? This article is amazing. This comes from the Sunday Sun newspaper in April 2009. I read to you the heading. It says, beware the dragon, warns magistrate. Well, who's the dragon? Well, that's the devil. You can read of him in Revelation 12. He is the devil. Now listen to what the first and the second last paragraph in this article says. It's time for Christians who observe Sabbath to prepare for the dragon that would want to impose on Sunday worshiping. The Sabbath observers are soon to face a strong challenge and even persecuted because of their beliefs. My friends, this is Revelation chapter 13, right here in my own country in the newspaper. Listen to what this article says. Bring back the blue laws. This is 2020. Which blue laws? Well, just go and Google Sunday blue laws. It's already on the books in the states, in the United States of America. They just need to enforce it. Even Fox News would ask these type of questions on their Facebook page. This is a screenshot from their Facebook. Should all stores close on Sunday to allow staff a day to recuperate? So once again, it's not going to come in, oh, this is the mark of the beast. It's a day to recuperate. A national Sunday law that contradicts God's law. Listen to what Mayor Cam Guthrie said. Just putting this out there for consideration. Once we kick COVID-19's butt, I suggest that everything be closed on Sundays again so that we can appreciate the importance of what taking a pause in our busy lives really means. I think our body, mind, and soul would thank us. Our body, mind, and soul would thank us, especially if we rest on Sabbath, the Saturday, not Sunday, my friends. Sunday should be made rest with family day, according to Hannah Yu. So people, leaders are calling for this, Sundays off. Italy's populace want to close stores on Sundays. So it's everywhere, my friends. It's coming. A modest proposal for a day of rest because of climate change. They saw that during COVID-19's shutdown that their carbon footprint was less. So now they're saying, like, if you look at this picture in China, where there are the pollution before the lockdown and are during the lockdown, you see hardly any pollution. And they say, well, if we have a day off, then surely the carbon footprint will be less and climate change would change the world and we would have a better place. Not just that, but this is one major thing they want to do. And the Pope is in agreement with this. This young lady, Greta, as she climate strikes every week, telling the world to shut down. Here we see a picture with her with the Pope. And in this video where the Pope meets with her, the Pope says to her, continue with what you are doing. Why would the Pope tell her this? What power do you have to meet the Pope like this? Or to speak at main events where you would speak to these leaders and you go and sit down. And the one video, she sat down next to Arnold Schwarzenegger. What power, or what power is behind you that you are capable of getting this right? Just a young girl. It tells me there is a message behind the scenes. They want to use this whole climate change agenda. I'm not saying it's not real. I'm saying they want to use it as a vehicle, like COVID-19, to bring in the mark of the beast, a national Sunday law. The Pope wrote in his letter, Laudato Si, this encyclical letter, he said that we need to bring in Sunday worship again. We need to tell people to force shops to close, etc., so that they can rest on Sunday, so that we can protect the environment. My friends, Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father. And then in verse 23, he says, depart from me, you who practice lawlessness, you who break my law. In the end of time, we're going to have two decisions. Either we worship God on his holy Sabbath day that points to him as the creator and receive the seal of God, or we worship the beast by worshiping on Sunday, even though we're worshiping God in ignorance. Many people, I did in ignorance, but I'm worshiping the beast because the beast enforced that day, and there is going to come the mark of the beast if I choose that day over God's Sabbath. We need to choose Jesus Christ or Antichrist. What will you choose, my friends? If you have liked this video and you would like to donate to this ministry, a one-time donation, our PayPal link is below. Send us a donation. We try to improve our work to make more free videos, and we would like to get more equipment and improve our equipment that we currently have. So your donation would be highly appreciated. If you want to become a patron and make monthly donations, you can do so also below, and you will have access to extra video seminars that I've done. You will have access to that. And pray for our channel as we make videos on a weekly basis to glorify God's name and to prepare people for the end. See you next time.